Welcome back to The Big Issue. My name is Mubarak Mugabo. Now we get into the biggest story of the week. Last week, we saw a woman member of parliament coming in from Tororo District, Sarah Upendi, seeking permission from parliament to introduce a private member's bill. That's a bill seeking to regulate alcohol manufacturing, consumption, and importation in the country. This actually bill, or proposed bills, came out to be a little controversial, where some of the stakeholders in this alcohol industry are opposing it because it sought to regulate on the time of starting to sell alcohol and barring people selling alcohol without licenses. But also inside the proposed bill, there are actually introduction of stringent penalties, including 10 million shillings, 5 million shillings as fine, but also jail term or imprisonment time of between 5 to 10 years of those people who are caught trying to offend and also to abuse the law. We just want to ask many questions. We understand that alcohol has a lot of economic and social benefits attached to it, but also it carries dangers and also to the public. Want to understand, where should be the balance? Was it necessary to have this bill actually being, you know, proposed in parliament? But also, is there any other way other than introducing a law to regulate this industry? Joining me to discuss that is the Director, Legal and Corporate Affairs at Uganda Breweries, but also the Chairman of Nile Breweries, rather, but also the Chairman of Alcohol Industry Association, Onapito Ekomoloid. A very good morning and welcome so much.
Good morning, Mubarak, and good morning, viewers.
For purposes of our viewers, I am a Muslim. I don't drink.
Please.
But
that is, I respect that, and it's nice speaking to someone
who doesn't,
who actually doesn't drink.
Yes, but doesn't have any problem with it.
You're also speaking to another person who doesn't drink.
Really?
But Who understands the industry?
This is a very interesting conversation. Although I don't drink, but I don't find any problem with people who are enjoying their drinks. It is their right, and it is their choice.
We are birds of a feather.
Absolutely. Mm. This bill is proposed by a woman member of parliament, who is certainly coming from an area that have a lot of people who are having so much defects caused by alcohol. Was it necessary, actually, for this bill to come up? And do you find any problem with this bill?
Look, first of all, I hope she has consulted her constituents and she's not on the wrong end of the electorate, which I suspect she is. Speaking for the alcohol industry, we feel this bill is grossly misplaced, ill-timed, and unnecessary. And maybe the only way to salvage it is to redefine the bill. And before, as a title, the first word should be illicit alcohol control bill or illegal alcohol control bill, unlicensed alcohol control bill. It must be specific. So we feel right now it's a misguided or missile. And it will not achieve anything. Because we fear that this bill, like many laws about alcohol in this country, have not understood that there are two categories of alcohol in Uganda. And the one which should be dealt with is actually the majority alcohol in Uganda. That is the illicit, the unlicensed, unregulated, untaxed, whatever, the unofficial, whatever you want to call it. That is where all the problems of alcohol in this country stem from. And it constitutes 65% of the alcohol that is consumed by Ugandans. So if you don't understand that fact, you are simply scratching the surface. So the law must, first of all, differentiate. And right now, we don't see it as intended to differentiate. It's actually going to target the legal alcohol, the lawful alcohol, the regulated alcohol. What do I mean? If you are thinking of beer, which I suspect when most people think of alcohol in this country, they look at beer, which is not surprising. beer is visible, mm-hmm. beer is advertised. I mean, it's in your face.
Mm.
So when you think of the problems of alcohol, you immediately think these beer people must be the ones who are causing. They are not. Because one, that beer, before it even gets out of our breweries,
mm.
has to be evaluated by Uganda Bureau of Standards. Mm-hmm. One, to verify that it's fit for human consumption. That's the most important aspect. And then there is a whole laws around before we put it out, how we label, how we produce. So it is clearly regulated.
Mm.
And then you have the tax element. Whether we're importing, whether we're producing within the country, the tax must be imposed and there are conditions for taxation. So again, it's already well controlled. Then before we sell anywhere in Uganda, The local authorities, be the KCCA, other cities, municipal authorities, they have trading licenses. So before you put it out, you must be registered as a trader. So clearly,
they are certainly triggers.
So there is a redundancy in the new law if you are looking at that kind of alcohol. But if you are looking at the alcohol in jerrycans, that nobody knows where it comes from. Nobody knows how it is produced. It is not labeled. There are no instructions on consumption. That is the problem. If you had look at it critically, most of the problem cases among consumers of alcohol fall within that category.
So what are you exactly opposed to? Because there are quite a number of ingredients in this.
We are opposed to.
You have a proposal to actually have the time.
Good. Let's go
regulated.
Let's go for the time.
Regulated.
Let's
because for sure there must be triggers for this bill before the proposal was tabled.
We are opposed
to time.
You have to start
selling beer or any alcoholic drinks starting from 12 p.m. That's noon. And then to 1 a.m.
Perfect.
Where do you find the problem?
First of all,
time?
We believe that alcohol must be consumed only by adults. And by adults who choose to drink it. Nobody should coerce them, not even us, the manufacturers, should go out of our way to seek to convert people who are teetotalers and others to drink alcohol. It should be a free choice. So we already know that. And we believe that those who drink have made a choice. So we believe in people's freedom. And I think Uganda is a land of freedom. So it's first of all unfair to assume that those who drink are stupid. They cannot make decisions.
No.
They are not saying
that you are stupid or any other person is stupid.
I'm saying
the people
who
are drinking.
But they just want to regulate
their time.
Please. So if you are not regulating the consumption of all other things in the world or in Uganda, why do you assume that those who drink must be policed? And in any case, you can drink anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
It's a personal choice. You can drink under your bed. You can drink in your bedroom. You can drink in your sitting room. You can drink anywhere. So for us, the problem and what we constantly tell our consumers is not to abuse alcohol.
Exactly.
And abuse is not limited to alcohol. Please do not abuse food.
But do not abuse anything. The facts on the ground show that actually many people have abused this alcohol. They are actually not taking care of their families because most of them actually wake up in the morning at 7 a.m., get to the bars.
Precisely.
So you rather close the bars where the selling point,
please.
You would have solved the problem.
I've just told you, the drinking does not take place only in the bars. So address abuse, address people's mindset. And we have a lot of research which shows that there are so many factors that influence people's decision to drink or not to drink. And the biggest of them is parents, for example. So it's not because the bar is open that you and I are not walking into it. It's a personal decision. A bar can be open, but somebody who is rational will not go into it. And we want, first of all, to assume that most Ugandans are rational. And we can reinforce through education messages. And we do, as the industry, reinforce people's decisions to be rational. And it's true that most Ugandans drink after work. Be it in the cities, most Ugandans, mark my word, and you'd be saying otherwise. We can walk out of the studio, we can walk out of the studio and walk across most of the bars and take statistics of how many people drink in the morning up to lunch hour, and how many people drink from 3 p.m. up to maybe midnight. 95% and more drink at the right time. So we need to get this minority through different personal and mass education to also drink at the right time. But again, I emphasize, it's also how you drink. You can go and drink after five, but drink badly. What is drinking badly? You go and engage in what we call binge drinking. In other words, you want to bring the whole crate and gulp it on the table. So it doesn't matter the time. It is the way you do it. If you drank at this hour in the morning and you drank one bottle or two, you are better than a person who drinks at 5 p.m.
But why would you drink in the morning before you even go to work?
But please,
I mean, that's the spirit behind
again,
this regulation.
Why would you? I think what you should worry about is what you drink. First of all, the kind of alcohol you drink,
yes,
which we say should be differentiated, and government should concentrate on. People should drink safer alcohol, regardless of the time.
Yes.
Two, the quantity you drink is important, regardless of the time. So the time of drinking is immaterial, depending on what you drink and how you drink. That's what matters.
There are actually some figures that might have triggered this whole conversation. We had members of parliament last time coming to chambers when they are drunk. And in 2016, one member of parliament from Mukono had proposed such another bill, which is related to that, which collapsed at some point. But you have a gym called City 5, which claimed 17 lives in Arua. You have World Health Organization ranking Uganda as top of those countries that are actually so much with alcohol consumption. Are these not really bad signs that requires such a regulation coming into existence?
They are bad signs, but they do not require the kind of regulations that are being proposed. First of all, it's a bad sign that there is illicit alcohol in the industry. What killed people in Arua is precisely the kind of alcohol we have been campaigning against as an industry. And you need to be pinpointed in getting that alcohol, first of all, verified by UNBS. We agree that all alcohol in the country should be verified by UNBS.
Yes.
We agree that all alcohol in the country should pay taxes.
Because
you are not looking at the economic and social benefits.
Because your interest is literally to protect your economic interests.
Not just my economic interests, but
the value chain
of alcohol is more than us, the manufacturers. First of all, much of the alcohol is manufactured from local agricultural products, largely grains. So the farmers who grow these grains get market. And there are a lot of people who are employed in the alcohol value chain. So it's not just about me and those who work for Nile Breweries, Uganda Breweries. And it contributes largely to the economy of the country through taxation. So we must protect all these benefits, but above all, you must protect the health of Ugandans. And protecting the health of Ugandans is not about the time somebody drinks, let me emphasize, is the alcohol someone drinks and how someone drinks.
We assume that many of the people, instead of going to work in the morning, they go to bars.
It's not true. It's true, Ona, in
many villages. I think this is rare.
But when you go to
many villages, you will find actually people at 7 a.m., 8 a.m., instead of being in their farmland, they are actually in the bars.
And those
and how do you address that as a leader?
Those who do, you may not still stop them. Even if you close the bars in the trading centers, if they do not abandon the habits of them drinking in their hearts, in their homes, you are not solving the problem. You are just driving the problem underground. And that has been tested in many parts of the world, that once you try to force consumption out of public spaces, which sometimes actually is self-controlling, because when we are together in a group, there are certain behaviors that the group enforces on the individual.
What are your fears, Ona,
in regulating this? I've just expressed to you.
What are your fears? Because, I mean, if you say
I have no personal fears,
no, I wouldn't find
what is possible or what is rational, what is irrational. I'm just explaining to you that you don't make a law which is redundant. And we as
are your fears making a law which is redundant, or there are negative effects that actually may come to you as the people in the business?
I don't even want to worry so much about us as business. We want to worry about our consumers and others who are not even our consumers but consume alcohol. The first thing I've told you is you are not solving a problem by saying don't drink at a particular hour.
What loss would you make if, for example, you have a redundant law?
No, it's a fact also that
has come out, it has a redundant law. What loss does this actually put on the industry or any other Ugandan? It's a redundant
law. It puts a loss on the Ugandan economy in the sense that you are restricting consumption to particular hours, which is not necessary. Two, there is this idea of saying license people to sell alcohol specifically. Remember, Ugandans are the most enterprising people. So many Ugandans have set up businesses across the country, small, medium, large. And one of the beauties of the Ugandan economy has been, especially the trading, is that once you have a license, you can literally sell anything that is legal.
Yes. No?
And now you are telling people that you must specifically have something for alcohol. Specifically, what stops people from saying next for soap, for oil? And you are killing the ability of small traders to trade with a variety of products, including alcohol, which is not useful.
Hola, Pito. This proposed bill is talking about prohibiting manufacture or sale without license. And the penalty is 10 million or imprisonment, certainly 5 years or both. Now, you have another issue coming out to say opening hours for alcoholic sale between 12 noon to 6 p.m., except for supermarkets, mobile vans, depots, and wholesale shops, that the fine is about 20 million or 10 years imprisonment or both. Number three, prohibit sale of alcohol inside passenger vehicles, sale to law enforcement officers, and sale to alcohol to persons below 18 years. Fine is between 3 to 10 years for breaking this law. What exactly is wrong with these kind of provisions?
The problem is that the law, the way it's being packaged, is mixing necessary and unnecessary aspects. So that immediately makes it a bad law. In other words, you need to separate first of all what is necessary and what is not necessary. I've just given you an example. You have read some examples, and some of them
are
redundant.
These are proposals.
So you say no selling in passenger vehicles. Is it taking place?
It does.
Which taxis and buses?
It does.
Which taxis and buses do they sell alcohol in them? I'm not aware. I'm not aware. So that one is a redundancy. So if you say, I've told you opening hours, that one is not necessary. No? It's not necessary. There's also something about age, which is so funny and contradictory.
It's about 25.
Remember, I'm sure the Honorable PND knows that all laws must be consistent with the Constitution inherently.
Yes.
So you have a country where a person of 18 years is allowed to become president,
yes,
which is the biggest responsibility in this country. But we are saying that person, 19, 20, 21, 20, up to 25, cannot drink alcohol. What are you talking about?
So in other words,
let's have a president, but he should not drink because he's not yet 25. If the president is 18, he can lead the country, can lead us to war, but he cannot drink.
Do you agree that actually alcohol has dangers that need to be regulated?
Alcohol,
whether acceptable alcohol
yes,
or not.
Alcohol, like many products, have dangers. And we believe that currently there are enough regulations in terms of what kind of alcohol gets into your body. That's why you have UNBS. And we are saying the only challenge is UNBS has not captured the whole spectrum of the alcohol consumed in the country. And it should be empowered to capture that alcohol. So you don't need this law for the alcohol to become safer. You need to strengthen UNBS.
Rwanda has actually similar law, which is regulating manufacture, sale, and also consumption of alcohol. Kenya recently, after the new president, came up with the same policy to actually have this business regulated. Why do you find Uganda, the Ugandan being, ridiculous? Well, and I will have this kind
Uganda
of conversation.
So, Uganda so after this very that short Kenya does not have, we don't have time limits and our age limits.
Let's have a short break. We're returning with this conversation. Welcome back to The Big Issue. My name is Mubarak Mugabe. We are discussing the alcohol control bill, which is proposed by the woman member of parliament from Tororo District, Honorable Sarah Opendi. With me in studio is Ekomoloit Onapito. He's the director, legal and corporate affairs at the Nairo Breweries. Ona, before we left for a break, I was asking you, Kenya recently, the new president proposed another policy, rather another law, to regulate this industry, but also Rwanda, it's quite effective, and they are really drinking hours. You don't open bars at, you know, in morning hours. Why is it so much hard for you to accept this kind of a regulation in Uganda, but it's working in the rest of the
countries
we are in the world?
Uganda is a land of freedom, first and foremost.
No.
Yes, just hold on. I'm serious. I'm told you, many people will not go to any other country. This country is a country of freedom, and I think that's one thing the NRM can be given credit for. You can say maybe to some extent it is a bit detrimental to allow people to do whatever they want, but Ugandans love their freedom and should have that freedom, especially the freedom to choose, a freedom
to drink,
so long as they are doing it within the safe limits. So I know, of course, I'm told, someone has told me that Rwanda is actually doing the opposite of what he is saying in terms of liberalizing the drinking hours. So maybe it has been, your information has been overtaken. But let's do our things the Ugandan way. But first of all, let me return to
Rwanda is seeing a problem. Kenya is seeing a problem.
No,
you don't say problem.
I'm just told that Rwanda is, I'm told, is now doing the contrary. It's allowing freedom. But Kenya has tried, but it has failed. You know, it has not really achieved anything. You can say the level of drinking in Kenya is not perhaps higher than Uganda, maybe. But again, I have no problem with people drinking, as I told you earlier, so long as they are drinking safe alcohol, which is the big problem in Uganda. The bulk of the alcohol, 65%, is not safe. Can we concentrate on making the alcohol safe before you worry about those who are drinking safe alcohol? How they drink is a personal habit, which has a lot of factors driving it. One of the major drivers often is poverty, is unemployment. You know, so you need to make sure that you address the underlying causes of unhealthy or alcohol abuse. You know, and let's concentrate on the word alcohol abuse. And abuse has nothing to do with time. No, abuse has a lot to do with the habits, the way of drinking.
Some of these ingredients actually, amounts to abuse. So are you just looking
like
for
what?
The word?
Like
for
what?
Example, drinking in the morning.
No, again,
morning hours.
No, I repeat, that is not abuse.
That's it's not it's abuse. What only?
Abuse is about quantity, about your age. If you are under 18 and you are drinking, that is abuse. If you are drinking when you are pregnant, that is abuse. If you are drinking
selling without a license,
when you are drinking when you are operating a machine, driving otherwise, that is abuse.
Selling without a license.
Selling without a license is criminal. You may say it's not really an abuse. For you is selling, that's not, you are not necessarily abusing, but you are breaking maybe the law. Yes.
So in other words, you don't find any relevance of this law. If it was really, because many people were saying that these guys are just opposed to it,
even
because
the law is
there is an impact that it is going to cause on yourself.
Yes.
So you are protecting your market.
Not just on ourselves, it's going to cause an effect on the entire economy, which is already experiencing a lot of stress.
Should we really lose a population simply because you are earning and the government is earning money?
We do not necessarily have to lose a population. We can balance, and we as an industry, we feel we are doing enough, and we work together with the government to reduce and stop alcohol abuse. But you shouldn't sacrifice the rest of the benefits of alcohol by bringing a draconian law, you know, which then hurts the alcohol industry, which hurts the economy. And I'm sure people in finance, people in URA out there, they know the truth. So we hope common sense will prevail, and a law which does not have relevance, which is draconian, is not allowed.
It doesn't have common sense simply because it is affecting or it's impacting on the incomes that you earn in the industry, on the huge amounts of money you give to government, but you don't care about people's livelihood.
No. We absolutely care about people's lives, but we say there is no contradiction between caring for people's lives and not allowing a draconian, irrelevant law.
There are actually figures, as I said, 12.4%, that's according to the World Health Organization.
Yes.
Ugandan men have an alcoholic disorder, and about 4.2% being dependent on alcohol. What are you doing to you people in the industry, in the alcohol industry and the brewing industry? What are you doing to save these people?
Why are you finding a problem when there is a legislator who is caring for these people
you're not caring about?
What we are doing is offering our consumers safe alcohol and making sure it is sold to them in a safe manner. And we go ahead to discourage those whom we think should not drink alcohol. The underage pregnant women, drivers who are actively driving, we discourage them. This is what we are doing. But remember, when WHO is referring to the problem of alcohol, they are perhaps not looking at the 65%, which is not in our hands. And we are telling government, go for it.
The 65% of the illicit alcohol.
Separate us from it. Don't make a law meant to catch thieves and even want to get innocent people. That is not a good law.
Yes.
Go for the thieves, no? So we totally agree that there is alcohol problem, but the torch must be shown in the right place.
We actually have to wind up this whole conversation, but before we do that, what do you think should be done in the first place? Because, and for sure, you agree that there is a problem, and this problem has to be addressed. How better can Uganda address this?
Change this law, to be specific, to regularize illicit alcohol in the country and make it safer and make it taxed such that it contributes meaningfully, first of all, to the safety of consumers, but it also contributes to the economy. Imagine, from only 35%, the government is realizing revenue that is significant to its collection in terms of alcohol contribution. Suppose it was 50%, 60%, 80%. So from a purely economic point of view, but also from a safety point of view, there is work to be done to regularize illicit alcohol. Let's concentrate on that. But don't come closing bars in Kampala because some decent person is choosing to get a beer at 11, that is not abuse.
I felt actually like alcohol must be, you know, an ingredient of a social event. Usually, yes. It is actually the most
largely.
It is largely on the largely, social event.
But there are people who can choose.
Suddenly, we don't have social events early in the morning.
To have it as part of their meal, some people take only one meal a day. They may go to a restaurant and have a meal with a beer. That is their choice, so long as it's a reasonable choice.
But remember, most of the bill is also protecting some of the, you know, the licensed people who are supposed to be selling this alcohol. Supermarkets, you know, depots and wholesale shops are protected. And these are actually your worries. If you want to buy alcohol, for example, in the morning, go to a supermarket.
But we are saying do not stigmatize bars. There's nothing, there's not even a bar and a supermarket. They are all places of decency. And remember, most of the people who go to bars, on the contrary, are people who work. And it is not common. You can go, most of the bars during these hours are just being cleaning up and raging their stocks.
There are many bars that we really see even here in town. You find them when you're coming to work.
It depends on what you call a bar. If you call some kiosk where people are selling whatever they choose a bar, then that's a different matter. But I think most bars do not operate during the stated hour, not because of
there are way out where if you want, for example, if you want, for example, owner, you want to have a beer, for example, on your breakfast, you can walk into the shop, into the depot, into the supermarket. What would be wrong with that?
Because what is wrong with me walking into a bar?
This is a working hour, certainly. I think they are trying to address that, and you may agree with me. Most of the people who are really who have really neglected their families are spending most of the morning hours in the bars.
A lot of people who take care of their families. We grew up from families where people drink, but they were taken care of. Let's not have a very low opinion of people who drink alcohol and think they don't know what they are doing. We know they know. So let's leave people to. We can educate, and we are continuing to educate, but we should not police, and above all, we should not try to punish personal choices.
What would be your message to people who are consuming alcohol and yet actually they are aware there are dangers in alcohol consumption?
I think there is no danger in alcohol consumption if it is, one, safe alcohol and consumed in the right quantity. Those are the two main parameters of abuse. Do not drink alcohol that you cannot confirm where it's coming from, its ingredients and what have you, and then do not drink alcohol in excess of what your body can tolerate. And this is not limited to alcohol. We are having a problem of obesity. Abuse, the same story. We're having a problem of addiction to phones. It's the same story.
Social media.
Too much of everything is dangerous. And this is the same thing that we should keep driving, especially into young people. It's not just about alcohol. Self-control is very important.
Yeah, but also there have been existing laws which were enacted in 1960s, the Angoli Acts and all of that. Isn't it necessary, honestly, 1960?
Fine.
The behavior has changed.
If those laws...
And Parliament is coming out to say these laws are outdated. We need a new law. I would think that many people or stakeholders in this industry would focus so much in strengthening the law other than opposing it being tabled in before Parliament.
You know, we are opposing because of the majority aspects that do not help, and yet the minority good aspects are already covered by other legislation. But above all, those aspects can covered more by education in families, by personal choices, and all kinds of other education. You don't have to make a law that then affects the good aspects of the alcohol industry and the right of consumers.
But these people, actually, these members of parliament, are interacting more with the individuals, with the people in the ground, so they know the problem, they are now trying to diagnose
the problem.
But
they are giving the wrong medicine. That's very common. It's very common. There's a good diagnosis, but then there's wrong treatment. We are saying the treatment can be
different.
Yes.
Oh, now we have to wind up this whole conversation. What is your last message about this whole conversation, and what advice would you give to our legislators?
I think our legislators are Ugandans. They know our people. They know their voters. They know
their voters are really drinking too much.
I think let's deal with the underlying problems of alcohol in Uganda, and that's first of all the unsafe nature of the vast majority of the alcohol that is produced in the country. Let's make sure we have a body called UNBS, you have URA, we have district authorities. Let's make alcohol safe, and then we continue to educate our people on avoiding excesses, not just in alcohol, but...
What do you call excesses? By the way, what do you recommend?
Look,
for drinking,
it's about your body. You should know your body.
Aye.
Yes, you should know your body. Like, and that's always the best thing, because what is enough for you may not be enough for me. This is a fact.
What do you recommend for an individual, else an adult, in one day?
No, what is recommended is you must still be able to make the choice that you have had enough. If you have reached a point of not being able to make that choice, then you have had too much.
But already you are drinking. How do you know that this is too much? Because the person who is already drinking...
No, but I mean, alcohol, first of all, is a food of its own. I'm sure we all eat, and you can always feel when you are satisfied. So drinking is not different.
It's not a different.
You should feel you are satisfied, and it should. There is tomorrow. In fact, at Nile Breweries, we have a Luganda expression that Nenchanunaku.
That when you drink too much, yeah, there's also tomorrow. There's you can as well take in.
Wait for tomorrow. Enough is enough.
But also, actually, this alcohol end up getting into schools and institutions.
And, you see,
and that's a very big problem.
And those are now bigger issues than the trading hours, you know? And that's where the parental element comes in. We must sort out the dysfunctionality that has cropped up in our society. In many families are dysfunctional and kids are not, have no inspiration. These are things which cannot be controlled by a particular law. It's a bigger issue. Yes.
So like, but of course with the bill, if the bill is put in existence, is put in place, some of these things are, you know, we expect them to be addressed. Certainly.
No, it's not the bill that will address them.
What will address it?
There are so many laws in this country, but we know that people still go ahead and do the wrong things. So the law should be necessary. I don't think this particular law is necessary.
All right. Thank you so much, Honor Peter, for that wonderful wrap-up. We have actually been discussing the alcohol control bill that was proposed by the woman MP for Tororo District, Honorable Sarah Opendi. We've been discussing what actually the dangers that this bill may cause to our national economy, but also to the social, you know, affairs of our people. My name is Mubarak Mugabo. We are taking a short break. Rush Hour returns with much more.
Urban.